Every entrepreneur has a unique story to tell, and our guest tonight is no exception. Dr. Michael Gilbert is the founder and CEO of semiosBIO Technologies, Inc., a company he started in the fall of 2010. His company, a leader in pheromone-based pest management, is located within the University Venture Labs Accelerator, a program, by the way, that every stakeholder at SFU has access to, which includes every single student in this room. Michael's company is listed as one of the top 20 most innovative companies in British Columbia by BC Business, finished in the top 10 of the New Ventures BC competition not once, but 2 years in a row. He was also a Verizon Powerful Answers top 5 finisher, no small feat, as it carries an award of $300,000. And for anybody that's taken entrepreneurial finance, that's fantastic, non-dilutive funding. He has raised millions of dollars in funding, speaking of which, and after years of research development, he is now producing revenue and is operating in five countries, which include Canada, the United States, Germany, Italy, and the Netherlands, and he has plans to expand into South America. Please join me in giving your best welcome for our guest, Dr. Michael Gilbert. What exactly is semiosBIO?
So semiosBIO is a precision farming platform. So what we do is we try and collect big data about agriculture and focusing on three main crops, fruits, nuts, and grapes. And we use that data to help growers make better decisions on which pesticides, which fungicides, when to water, all kinds of decisions that help them essentially save money and then create a better product.
And you have two core products?
Kind
of. Or two core focuses?
Yeah, well, I would say I was unfocused at the beginning, and as a result, now I have two companies. But we started out developing a pheromone-based bed bug product, and then we also created this platform for ag, and the second one ended up being the bigger of the two companies, for sure.
Right. Okay, so we'll come back to those, but now that they know what semiosBIO is, let's find out a little bit more about you and how you got to this chair
sure.
with us this evening. You were born in 1973, and you were born in Quebec. Where in Quebec were you born?
It's a small town called Chicoutimi, and it's about 8 hours north of Montreal.
And were you raised there, or have you been? How long before you came to British Columbia?
I'm what's known as an army brat, so I moved every 3 years. So my dad was in the military, so lived in Chicoutimi for a few years, then Ottawa, Montreal, Quebec City, Germany twice. So kind of all over the place.
So mostly between Canada and Europe?
Yeah.
So you got a lot of international experience. Probably had to make friends, learn to make friends fast, going to different schools all the time.
Learning different languages, making friends quickly, yeah.
How many languages can you speak?
Three. Yeah.
So English and?
French, German.
French and German. I wish I was better so that I was able to test you in both of those languages.
Yeah, I'm glad you're not.
So. I think all I know is choose. That's I can say hi and goodbye. That's basically it. What would you suggest was your first exposure to any sort of entrepreneurial experience?
I'd say it's when I came back after my postdoctoral fellowship, I came back to Vancouver and started working for a small biotech company called Active Pass Pharmaceuticals. And I was the fifth employee. And so I kind of got a good feel of what was happening in terms of like raising money and trying to get grants and all that kind of aspects of small business.
Right, so even though you were an employee, it was a very entrepreneurial culture. And so you got your first entrepreneurial experience there. And that was after completing quite an extensive education.
Yeah, I was in my 50s when I started working, yeah.
Right. So let's walk through from graduating high school, the various degrees that you did before you got into the workforce.
So I started with a bachelor's degree in biochemistry from the University of Ottawa. And then I spent a year in Montreal working for a company called Merck Frost, and they're a drug company. After a year there, I applied to do my PhD at UBC. So I came out to UBC. Spent 5 years doing a PhD in organic chemistry, and then I took on a postdoctoral fellowship at the University of Vienna, also in organic chemistry, for 2 years.
Now, Vienna,
that was really your first opportunity where you started working with more than just yourself. You started working with large interdisciplinary teams. What was that like?
Yeah, I mean, it was, well, at the beginning it was interesting because I was the main native English speaker in the group. And so all these Austrians wanted me to translate their journals and their articles for them. And it's not really what I was hired for. So I quickly kind of sent them to like, go get a translator and started managing the group. And it was in Austria, or at least in Europe, a lot of the work you do is you're doing with different universities. And it's very common to have on the phone every day with another university. And so trying to help them figure out what's the right project for them and how do they leverage other schools.
Right. And so not only lots of different types of people, lots of different languages, but also different backgrounds and interests.
Yeah, because at the time we were developing, these were cardiovascular products, and we had a biology group, I think, based out of Madrid, and we had a chemistry group, and then we had a formulation group based out of England, so different groups coming together to try and solve a problem.
And correct me if I'm wrong, but that probably gave you some background. You were part of a major acquisition that happened. I think it was by your previous company, Merck.
That's right, yeah. So I, after my stint at Active Pass Pharmaceuticals, I worked for a company called Cardiome. They're a local company that's still around, based in Vancouver. They develop products for atrial fibrillation. And I joined them in 2006. They were about 80 or 90 employees. And I was there for 3 years working in their manufacturing division. And at the end of that stint, they sold the main asset to Merck for just over $800 million. It was the largest biotech deal in Canada at the time.
Was that number eye-opening to you, see somebody sell a product for
$800 million?
Yeah, it
was pretty fantastic. And we didn't know much. I mean, the management team at Cardiome kept it for a reason, because they're a public company. They can't really let these things leak out. But we knew something was happening because we're doing a lot of due diligence. We're photocopying things. We're scanning things. And then one day we had this, like, kind of everyone in the room have a big meeting, and then boom, they sold the main asset for $800 million, which is kind of a mix. First you're like, yay, and then you're like, well, what about my job? And then you're kind of like, oh, and then I think it was maybe 2 weeks later we had that meeting, which was, all right, everyone has to meet with their bosses today, and you'll find out whether you're staying or going. And I think 2/3 of us left that day.
Right, and that included yourself.
Including myself, yeah.
Right,
yeah.
And so you're out, you're looking for new opportunities, you're on the back of this $800 million deal, and somehow an SFU professor stumbled across your path, asked you to look at something.
Yeah, I was one of the guys I did my PhD with at UBC, is now a professor at Simon Fraser, and he's an organic chemist, and he does some work where he will design the synthesis of a class of chemicals called pheromones, and he was working with a professor who does the biology side, and they had this product that they're trying to sell to the Iranian market for pistachios. And he knew I had an exposure to the business side because I spent time at Cardiome in manufacturing, and asked me if I wanted to look into it, and I did. But the professor decided to sell the asset to an Iranian group. But that kind of got me thinking about what was that market like, and could I apply my skills there?
Right. And so you had this question in your head about whether or not pheromones could be a real alternative to pesticides. How'd you go about answering that question for yourself?
Well, I guess at the time my daughter was 6 months old, and my wife and I were trying to decide what to do. Either I was going to get a job, or she'd go back to work. And she went back to work, and so I was home, so I had all this time to, like, between feedings and feeding my baby, that I had to kind of think about what to do next. And so I spent a ton of time thinking about pheromones and chemistry and agriculture, and I knew nothing about agriculture at the time. So trying to figure out what was the space like, were there opportunities, and looking a lot at transactions in this space, so small companies who are being acquired, what kind of technology did they have, and trying to assess, you know, was there kind of a movement here or not.
Right. So, I mean, if stage one was locking yourself in your room and learning everything you could about the industry and about pheromones, while your wife is helping feed the bills and you're taking care of the kids. Phase two involved you going out and, I mean, in classes we'll call this validating the market, but you actually went out and started talking to people to learn things. How did you actually get in front of people? I mean, I can't imagine that was easy to do.
It's tough, and you get a lot of no's, and a lot of no's and more no's, and you kind of like don't know how you're gonna get through to these people. I found that early on, the best way to get someone's attention is you gotta figure out what it is they want, what do they like. So it's all about what's in it for me. It's pretty selfish world out there. People wanna know what's in it for them. And so you gotta figure out quickly, what do you have to offer to them? And so it could be that, you know, you read one of their papers and so you wanna talk about their research, or maybe they know somebody in another company, you wanna talk about that, but you gotta figure out what they wanna talk about, otherwise they're not gonna wanna talk to you. Essentially.
Right. So, what kind of tactics would you use if you identified somebody? What would you actually? What steps would you go through in order to get these people in front of you?
I would. I use LinkedIn a lot, so I'm a big fan of LinkedIn. So, and I pay for the premium product because I know I can get connected through other people to someone I want to speak to, and trying to get a warm introduction is obviously probably the best way in. If I can't, I typically will email somebody first, and then call them. So I don't want to. I find it hard to cold call someone out of the blue and explain what it is I do, but an email, a short email that says like, "Here's what I do. I'm going to call you tomorrow," and then I just call them. And I don't wait for an answer. I'm just going to call them back. At least I'm pretty sure they would have read at least the heading of the email, if not the entire email. Yeah.
And what kind of? How would you engage them and make sure that they took an interest in you? I mean, these are really busy people.
Yeah, I mean, get to the point quickly. I mean, trying to take more than 10, 15 minutes. I mean, they might be between meetings, so trying to keep it really short. And quickly touch on what I think they want to talk about, and then try and sneak in what I want to talk about before I end the call. So.
Yeah, I think when we talked, you talked about talking to them about problems that the entire industry was facing and maybe they were facing too, or if they weren't necessarily a business, if they're a researcher, talking to them about how they might commercialize their project or how they might, since you had the business side, you know, bringing the business conversation in. The professor that specifically brought you in originally, how did that relationship play out? Exactly, how did it go from just conversations?
I know at one point we talked about doing some work together, and then NSERC had a new program called Engage, which is a great grant program. You guys should look into it. Essentially, if you have an idea that you think you could use the help of a professor or a research group, and it could be lab facilities, it could be their opinion, there's a whole bunch of reasons why you'd want to engage the professor, they'll grant the professor $25,000 for you two to engage together. That's what it's called, Engage. And the idea is it would eventually lead to what's called a CRD grant, which is one where both companies, or the company would contribute cash, and that's how you kind of start. So just having a conversation, the professor can get $25,000 into their bank account. And so obviously that's of interest to a lot of, especially younger professors just starting out, who may be kind of between money and trying to find more money.
Yes,
so that's
there's some hungry professors in this audience that are probably following up with you. And that, just so I get that right, that's the NSERC Engagement Grant.
Engaged
grant.
Yeah.
And that allowed you to get some preliminary results. And specifically, it sounded like bed bugs and agriculture were starting to look like potential places to establish a business.
I think when you, those Engage grants, I mean, you get a bit of results, and if you're lucky, you get some results early on. But I think what it does is it kind of validates what you're doing, and then you can go to investors and say, hey, I got this Engage program going, I got Professor so-and-so working on our project, and that somewhat validates that it's not just some Yahoo idea, but somebody else actually is buying into your idea.
And so now you've got somebody working on your idea, you've got some preliminary results, you're at your son's soccer game, and I think this is where you came across your second SFU part-time professor.
That's right, yeah.
So what happened at the soccer game?
So I found out that one of the dads of our son's soccer team was he's a CEO of a local company called Indel Therapeutics. He was also an adjunct or associate professor at SFU in terms of in the MBA program for teaching about technology adoption. And I kind of quickly mentioned to him, hey, I know you do this. I'm looking for help. I want to start a company. And he kind of said, I don't have time right now, but why don't you put your thoughts together, come to my house, and I'll give you half an hour and tell me what your idea is, and then we can go from there. And he loved it. He thought it was a great area, a great market. And from there, he ended up becoming my advisor and then eventually a director of the company. So it kind of led from there.
And what did the two of you work on together to get started?
We worked on my pitch deck for investors. That's like, I had never done anything like that before. Pitching to investors is, it's a lot less about technology, more about the big scheme of things and thinking big and what's gonna happen, how you're gonna change the world. And I think as, maybe as Canadians or myself for sure, I was kind of like, well, it'll never be that big. It'll be kind of this small thing happening here. And no one wants to hear that and no one's gonna buy into it. So you have to kind of think about how big could this potentially be if you had all the money in the world, how big could this be? And then that's what they want to hear. Because I'm thinking, well, if I only have 50 grand in engaged grants, it's only going to get this big. But if I had 100 million, what could this do? And that's what you have to be thinking about. And that took a while for me to kind of get around, you know, talk about big picture, how can I really change the world with my ideas.
So that first deck, the first deck that you put together, you took it to Angel Forum. What were the contents of that deck? What were the basics of your pitch this early on in the company?
It was basically like, so at the time I was pitching bed bug control, and this is at a time where it was all the rage here and the library is having problems and everyone was having problems with bed bugs. And so I pitched that we had this technology that was going to be first to market and that we would have this unlimited market capture that we could do, and talked a bit about the team and my thoughts about who would buy the company in the end. And that's what we pitched. And we had 8 minutes to pitch it, so.
And what was the outcome?
We were voted the number one company of that forum. I think there was some 35 companies, so pretty lucky. And I had a list, I think, of 29 investors who wanted to follow up with me. Then I set up a due diligence meeting, so I had them come in, and three showed up out of 29. So I booked this huge room at a lawyer's office, and three people showed up. but they told their friends, and eventually we had five investors who put in $250,000 into the company.
Right, so five investors, $50,000 each.
Yeah.
And that was your first, like, real investment.
It was awesome.
Yeah.
It was phenomenal. Yeah, I couldn't believe it. I actually picked up my first check at a Tim Hortons, and we met for coffee, and then he just signed the agreement and handed me a check for 50 grand. And I was kind of like, oh my God, this is happening for real.
Would you mind taking the students through the financial journey that your company's been on so far?
So we had two engaged grants. So we had 50 grand in the bank, that we had leveraged. So the term leverage you use all the time as an entrepreneur. So you're leveraging this, leveraging that. So leveraging NSERC. So you tell your investors that, listen, you put in $250,000. I've already leveraged it with another 50 grand. So it's like you have 300,000 bucks. And with this, I'm going to get more grants. And therefore, your $250,000 is going to become like $500,000. And they just love to hear about that. And in Canada, like nowhere else in the world, there are tons of grants available to you, right? So we started getting more bigger grants. I got my first IRAP grant. And then the big one for us.
So what's an IRAP grant? Because you and I know what it is.
All right.
But they don't necessarily know
so
what it is.
So the National Research Council, so NRC, has a program called IRAP. And they're the first ones that actually funded my salary. So that was a big move for us. So the other ones gave money to the academics. IRAP, if you get an IRAP grant, you essentially tell them, here's what I'm going to do, and here's my salary. And every month they'll pay your salary for you. They'll pay a percentage of it. So I think it's 75% of your salary. So that means
you got to come up with the other 25%
exactly.
Somehow.
But that was the first time we actually started getting paid as entrepreneurs.
And what was it like to get an IRAP grant? What was the process?
IRAP is about finding an ITA, which is a industry technology.
Yes, advisor.
Advisor.
Industrial ITA. Technology advisor.
And there's probably a couple dozen in Vancouver, maybe at least a dozen. And you find one who. And they will essentially listen to you, and eventually, if they believe that you actually have the ability to raise more cash and make this into a company, because IRAP is their success is based on you eventually growing the company and hiring people. So they want to invest in people who are going to hire people. So if you can show that path to them and explain to them well, then they'll commit to you, and then you'll get. I think my first one was for $35,000, and then it went up to $150,000, and then eventually $200,000. And essentially, I could use that money to then hire more people.
So as the company grows, they're willing to invest more and more and more and basically become a partner.
Yeah.
Okay, so we got IRAP, and we're still moving ahead because there's more money in the pipeline.
Exactly. Just one more thing on IRAP is it's very cyclical, so you have to know that IRAP runs out of money. I think they launch it April 1, and they're out of money by April 30th. So you have to make sure you're talking to your ITAs in the fall, and you get them learning.
The fall of the year before.
The year before.
Yeah.
So that they're all lined up, and you've signed everything, and then so they can have it ready for April 1.
Yeah. So we're talking to our IRAP advisors now to get money
exactly,
in April 1.
I just finished my project scope for my next year. Yeah, same. So the next big coup for us was we applied for to a program called Sustainable Development Technology Canada, SDTC. Sorry, lots of acronyms in the investment world.
And this fund has a special focus, right?
Right, so they focus on anything to do with cleaning up the environment. So if you have an idea that's going to be make Canada a more sustainable economy, then they're the person to talk to. And they have probably the most money in Canada. So they have $1 billion to spend. So lots and lots of money, lots on solar, lots on industry waste and stuff like that. And the application is like, it's like that tall once you finish printing it out. I mean, it's massive.
I remember seeing the plunger.
It was scary. So the good thing is first you do a letter of intent, and that takes probably maybe 2 weeks of work. But then if you get approved to submit the second one, now you're talking about 3 months of work. And that's full time, you writing and researching all this stuff. But the carrot at the end is that it was a $10 million project that would give Semios $3 million cash. So big undertaking. But if the LOI gets through and they like what you do, then it's worth just sitting down and writing this out. And it's hard because you're in the middle of trying to raise money and trying to build your business and build your technology. But if you find a grant of that size, I would say, in my case, it was definitely worth sitting down and making sure you get it done. And make sure it's really well written.
And this is non-dilutive funding. This is a grant.
Yeah, this is all cash into the company. And as entrepreneurs, you'll quickly learn what non-dilutive means to you. But that's just amazing for you. So if you can maintain control of the company, all the non-dilutive money helps you do that.
And I think this particular grant gave you an opportunity to meet the Prime Minister. Is that right?
That's right, yeah. So they invited us over to, it was in Ottawa, to a dinner with the Prime Minister, and I think it was the French President as well, had us out there. So it was good to meet with different politicians, and kind of, one thing you have to learn also with grants, and with any politicians, I guess, in general, is you want to make sure that you kind of like show them how you pay it back. And so whenever I talk to my granting agencies, I talk to them about, I like to mention them to investors. IRAP helped me out, NRC helped me out, SDTC helped me out, more jobs created, all the lingo you have to learn, because that's what they want to hear is how, because then they report back. You know that your contact at a granting agency reports to somebody else, and they got to report on metrics like how many jobs were created from your companies, how much money was made, so they want to report back to things. So you have to give them little nuggets to bring back to their superiors.
And is that all the funding that you've received so far, or have you raised other money?
So I raised $2.5 million from angel investors, $7.5 million in grants so far, and we have had awards of, we had the $300,000 this year from Verizon, and I think there's a few more too, and now I'm forgetting them. But
So in total, since starting out in September 2010, going from an idea to where you are now, you've raised over $10 million. Right, most of which has not taken an ownership stake.
Right.
So you've been able to hang on to a large chunk of your company, get $10 million of money into your company. How are sales going?
Good. So we spent 2.5 years developing the product. This was our first year of sales, so we did $250,000 in sales this year. We just got our orders, some pre-orders for next year. The first one came in for $600,000. US, that's one customer, so that's pretty exciting. And now we're just kind of building out and preparing for next year. We should do somewhere between 1 and 2 million next year in revenue.
And what exactly is it that you're selling?
So we sell a service to farmers. So we actually have this new business model for agriculture. Agriculture in general is measured in terms of acres or hectares, depending on if you're a metric or not. And we charge a service fee per year for every hectare for which we deliver data to. So an apple grower with 100 acres, will pay $150 per acre per year for our service. And so it's a recurring revenue model, which is another one that everyone loves today. You don't want to be selling widgets, you want to be selling a widget at a dollar, but selling the service attached to that at $10 a year kind of deal. So, and that's what we do.
That's fantastic. So I have, we're going to get into the kind of the question and answer part of this.
Mm-hmm.
I have five questions that pertain to your company. I have three personal questions. And then the audience is being encouraged to write questions, and Sarah is going to pick her top three. So if anybody in the audience has questions, I would suggest you keep sort of sending them that way, and Sarah will pick her top three, and we'll do those. And then we're going to open it up to questions from the audience.
Sure, yeah.
Sound good? So question number one. People often refer to pivots, especially in the startup community. Has your company ever pivoted?
Definitely. So we started out as a company. I thought we were going to be developing new types of pheromones for agriculture. So new types of chemicals, which makes sense because I'm a chemist. So you kind of make the connection there. We pivoted to becoming a data-driven company and a wireless network company. And chemicals make up less than 10% of our business. So that's a big pivot for me, for the company and for me. So I run a team of 25 engineers, and I have no idea what a scrum is. So I had to kind of learn what programming is like, and I don't even know what half my staff do, but kind of that was a big pivot for me. The scrum essentially is the group working on that sprint, and you have a scrum master who then kind of decides at assigning tasks and making sure people are being honest about their timelines and reevaluating either midway through the sprint or at the end of the sprint.
Right, so this is something that a lot of entrepreneurs deal with. You know, you get $10 million into the company, which is great because you can now hire all of these new people, but trying to figure out how all these people are going to align their goals to what the goals of the company are and making sure that you're maximizing these resources and people are actually feeling fulfilled and like they're part of the team, it's a huge challenge. If anybody in the class wants to get more information on that, there's a great book called The Rockefeller Habits that go through Scrum, sprint mentality, etc. And it works outside of software development, which I guess you guys probably have some software and hardware development, but
yeah,
other things as well.
Well, so, I mean, we all know how important software is, and I think I saw an article today about the next 10,000 business plans are going to be about here's a product and here's my AI my UI that goes against it, right? So it's all going to be about how do you interface with products and services, and then how do you collect data about it. So I think in most businesses today, you have to understand how software gets developed.
Yeah. So if you don't know what sprint and scrums are yet, you probably will be a part of one or making one at some point in the future. For your second question, second five, how has your focus changed as CEO of the company in terms of the departments and the divisions that you pay the most attention to? How have you seen it evolve as the company has grown?
So I was definitely mostly in product development and at the same time trying to raise money. So those are my two roles at the beginning. And then as we got more and more grants, it became a lot about finance. So accountability for grants is important. You don't want to mess up in any of your submissions. So understanding how accounting works. And the past year and a half has been definitely moving to 90% business development and sales. So what I do most of my days is trying to figure out who are the right channel partners to sell our product? How do I build a sales team? And how do you build it? Because that, in the end, that's what the business is going to be. You have to kind of stop. It's tempting to go back and do product development and get kind of involved.
Revise.
Yeah, and just personally get involved. But I have to kind of leave that to the team and focus on business development.
Right. Yeah. Which actually leads me perfectly into my next question is, what are the key lessons that you've learned so far in sales and marketing?
It's hard to build, I think it would be hard to build a sales force, a sales team. It's expensive. And in Canada, you get a lot of money for engineers and researchers, but none for sales. There's not one grant out there that's going to pay you to hire a sales guy. So it's tough to focus on that beginning. And so I think what I did was try and figure out what kind of partners could I find that would sell the product for me. And we were very successful in doing that. Finding big companies that wanted to sell our product, and therefore I could leverage their sales force.
That's good. Number four, what lessons have you learned about building a team, and how have your problems changed from just being yourself to having, how many employees do you have now?
I think we're at 32 now.
Yeah, from a one-man show to 32 employees, and I would expect still growing.
So at some point, I had a, what we'd call a very horizontal organization, so I had everybody reporting to me, which kind of works well when you're a micromanager like myself, kind of like seeing what everyone's doing, and everyone tells me what they're doing. But after a while, that doesn't work anymore, and you can no longer communicate enough with people, so you have to start hiring managers and people who can run things. And that's hard at the beginning, because you kind of want people who are going to do things. Like, I want you to either write program, or I want you to fix this product, or do something. And managers don't really do that. They kind of just manage people. And it seems kind of like a waste of money, but then it takes so much work off your plate that it becomes, you kind of wonder how you did it before that. So at some point, you have to invest in that, and that what really helps the team, because then everyone has more contact with their managers, and everyone's happier. Because if you're managing, and at the time I was managing about 17, 18 people on my own, and they don't get enough attention from me, and so no one's really happy.
Right. Well, the last question is a little open-ended, so you can dig deep and really talk about whatever you want, and it's good because it launches into the three personal questions. For the students here today, what is your best piece of entrepreneurial advice, given your experience to date?
I would say, if you're not typically optimistic, then entrepreneurship's probably not for you. So you have to be, you get so many no's and people saying, like, there's no way you can do that. How are you going to go against Monsanto? There's no way. They're going to kill you, right? And everyone says no. And not just like investors, your family, your friends are like, what? You have a PhD, go get a job. I'm like, but I want to do this. And so get a thick skin and stay positive and just focus on what you want to do. Because when it happens, it's so much fun. And when you start, when you get that, like when I got home with that first check from a Tim Hortons, I'm going like, there's only 50 grand, which is, from now is not much, but at the time it was like, changed my world, right? It was like, that's the first time I thought, I'm going to have a business. This is going to be for real. I'm going to be a CEO. I'm going to grow this company. And it's been a blast. I mean, I love my job. I don't even think of it as a job. I mean, it's just so much fun to do. And as a CEO, I can pick whatever I want to do each day. I can decide I'm going to go spend time with the developers today. I'm going to call the sales guys, I'm going to finance. You pick exactly what you're going to do in every single day, and you have full control of what you spend, what you think about. The flip side is you spend a lot of time thinking about it. But it's, yeah, just stay optimistic because it's a fun ride. I love it.
I had a friend of mine who's also an entrepreneur here in Vancouver, and he said, if you want to be an entrepreneur, you have to be willing to spend every day ready to take on the world and every night crying in the bathtub. And so I guess that eternal optimism is definitely helpful. I mean, there has to be a can-do attitude because everything is going to go wrong all the time, right?
Everything takes longer, and you have issues that you didn't think you'd have. You have HR issues. You have people who are not happy. You have people leave. Super frustrating. Someone who's been working there for a couple of years leaves the company. Now you got this big hole in the company. You have to fill it. And so things come at you sideways all the time. But, you know, it's so much fun. Yeah. I love it.
So would you see yourself having a job anytime in the future?
I can't see it. I don't know how I would do that. Go back. Yeah. Hopefully I would. Don't have to. But I really enjoy it. And at the very least, I think I would join a startup if I was going to be in a... An employee.
So it'd be the same atmosphere at least.
Yeah, co-founding a company.
So I have three personal questions, and then we'll move on to questions from the audience.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, who is your favorite entrepreneur of all time and why? We didn't give him these questions.
I read a lot of what Richard Branson has to say. I think, so he, for those of you who don't know, he started Virgin. Mobile and Virgin Atlantic and all those companies.
Galactic now, yes.
I think what I like about Richard Branson is I love how he always seems to be having fun, and that's important to me. And he's always kind of like, always has a smile, and he likes to add that to his businesses, and he likes to create that kind of culture. Not quite cult, but maybe more culture. And I like that. I hope that I can have companies that way too, that are people are like love to be there and excited, and you have a nice fun atmosphere. That's kind of what I like to do.
That's a good answer. I like Richard Branson. The second question, what profession, other than your current one, would you like to one day attempt?
I think helicopter pilot.
Helicopter pilot.
Yeah, I love how helicopters move. I think it's pretty phenomenal.
Do you want to do that recreationally, or do you want to do that as a career?
I guess if I could get paid to do it, even better. But if I can afford one day to buy my own, then I'll just do that too. It's fine.
What has been, and so the reason I ask this question is because we know that entrepreneurs, you know, an 80-hour work week isn't even considered full-time yet. There's lots of entrepreneurs and, you know, people like Steve Jobs and the like whose work-life balance suffer when they're head down, nose to the grindstone. And so I wanted to ask, what has been the best thing you've done to improve your own quality of life in the last 10 years?
Commuting by bike is a good one for me. So it allows me to kind of, and I live at UBC and I work at Clark and Second, so it's about a 45-minute commute. So cycling helps me clear my head out. What I find is on the way home, I'm done my day at work, but that 45 minutes puts in another 20 emails I gotta write. So as soon as I get home, you know, I got my kids like, "Hey, Daddy," I'm like, "Hold on, I gotta just write 10 emails and then I can relax again." But it's good. It helps for sure. I don't know very many who have it figured out. It's a lot of hours. But I mean, it depends if you think of it as work. I mean, I don't think of it as work, but I probably count more of the hours that I don't think about work. You know, there's probably half a dozen in the week where I'm not thinking about my company.
Is there anything that you'd like to do or have been planning to do to improve your quality of life, your own personal quality of life?
I've been always meaning to get away, like where I can't get cell phone reception, somewhere where I really am disconnected. I've yet to do that. I've always been somewhere where I can at least daily get my email updates and see what's going on. But I think that'd be fun to try one time, just to get away with somewhere where there's just no connection. Yeah.
Okay. The first question, I don't know who this comes from, but we'll hopefully identify him or her later on. After you lost your first job, how does one find the motivation to start a startup? I mean, you already had a family at the time.
Desperation. I think I really want to stay in Vancouver. I mean, I love the city. I didn't want to leave, and the prospects in biotech were slim, and so I kind of thought, if I want to make a go at staying in Vancouver, I got to find my own job. I got to make my own job, and I already was interested in that. And it just kind of gave me that last kick that, like, you know, now's the time, or we're gonna move. So, figured it out.
Our second question is, you mentioned keeping your employees happy. How have you made sure to create happiness in the workplace? Do you have corporate events? How have you created a culture, etc.?
We try to, and we're always pushing towards that. We do things like, we always have free snacks and free fruit. We always have a bowl of fruit in the office so people can have snacks. We have flex hours so people can work at home if they want to. We have core hours if they have to work in the office. We have a...
That's interesting. What are the core hours for your office?
They're 10 to 3.
10 to 3. So the people that want to stay really late can sleep in, and the people that want to work really early can leave early.
Exactly, yeah.
Right.
In the summertime, we have a fun day event. So this year, we were stand-up paddleboarding out off of Jericho, and we had some fun events and a barbecue. And... the second week of December, we have what we call our family reunion. So I have staff in Vancouver, and I have staff in Ontario, and staff in Europe. And I'm flying them all to Vancouver for a week. And we have a week of strategic planning, because a lot of people who work off-site lose that connection with the team. And so this is their chance to kind of sit down for us for a whole week. And it's a busy week, so every day is like a planning strategy session for next year. But then we end it with our Christmas party, which is going to be at a pub. We're going to rent out a whole pub and just have a big beverage fest.
Excellent. are guests allowed to attend this beverage fest?
We do a plus one, but you got to get on the list.
Okay,
yeah.
Well.
And it's open bar, so it's like a big night for everybody. It's a big expense.
I'll have to start being more friendly to people in your office.
Exactly.
The last question before we'll open up the mic. What was your biggest struggle when the money started coming in? Specifically, how did you go about planning properly and organizing and dealing with the money once you had it?
You have to manage expectations of your team. You know, it's kind of confusing to a team to hear, well, you got $3 million, why am I not getting like a big raise? And So you have to kind of like talk about, this is for the next 2 years, we have to grow the team. And so, you know, compensation is a very, very difficult thing to manage as an entrepreneur. As a founder and as a majority shareholder, I'm compensated in different ways. So I have the upside of the company, right? But staff, you know, they have to get paid. And so you got to figure out what's the right salary versus stock options you can give them and what keeps them happy. But, you know, cash can, people can, don't always understand how you spend that money. And so it's tough.
Vancouver is kind of an interesting place. I mean, if you go down to San Francisco, everybody wants stock options. Everybody understands it. Everybody knows how to calculate the value of it. What was your experience in hiring people and determining the mix between compensation and stock options, or even explaining what stock options are or how they work?
I don't think anybody, maybe one or two, knew what they were. I mean, when you talk about, I talk about equity in the company, then they kind of get it, but it's not really understood here how that works. And, you know, lots of questions that I thought would have been pretty obvious, like, do I got to pay for them now or later? And then, so explain to them how that works. But most of my staff appreciate it. So we decided at early stage, we had 4 co-op students at the time, at the beginning, and they were phenomenal. And they all got stock options in the company. And they still, and we created a new stock option pool that said that they would keep on holding on to stock options as long as they were in school and for a year after they left. And if they didn't come back to the company, then they would expire. But if they came back to Semios, then they get to keep the equity. So it was kind of a way for them to go back to school and not worry about it. And they still have those stock options.
Oh, that's fantastic. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that concludes my job. Well, almost. I guess I'm going to intermediate the questions. But before we get into the open questions, could we just get, please, a big round of applause for Michael for coming around and sharing his time with us today. You'll find that there are a lot of entrepreneurs out there who are very secretive about their businesses. So for Michael, who is growing his business, has just launched into revenue, has had, you know, starting of quite a bit of success, to come in and be very open about how he's building his team, what he's doing with his money, the money that he raised. This is a very unique opportunity, and especially to let us film it. So thank you very much for all of that. We'll take questions from the floor. Don't be shy. Somebody break the seal. Go ahead.
Hey, Mike. So you pitched for Angel Deck, and you took first place out of 35 companies. What do you think makes a great pitch? And what do you think of the new shows focused on entrepreneurs pitching, like Dragon's Den and Shark Tank?
Good question. I've often been asked why I have not pitched on Dragon's Den, and I think that is, you know, 95%, you know, entertainment for sure. I think for us to have success was connecting with the crowd. So angel investors in particular invest in people, and so they want to know, like, if they're going to give you this money, how do they know you're not going to run away with it and just waste it? You know, so they want to be able to call you, and they want to have an interest in what you're doing. So you have to be personable. You have to be able to talk to the audience and get their feedback and kind of sense that, and be pretty open. And if you're kind of like, if you come across as uncoachable, which is a big red flag in any kind of pitch form. So if you come across as, I know it all, give me money, I'll just take care of it for you, though they won't believe you for a second. So you have to be kind of like open, like, well, I know this, I know chemistry, and I know this. I don't know how to sell things, but I can build this part. Then they'll kind of think like, well, he's coachable, and then maybe I can help him out or I can advise him on that. So.
This question is to do with your agriculture company. So farmers, they often get like a government subsidy. And when you sell your product to them, like, do you sell to the government or do you market to the farmers? And like, what are the differences in, I guess, convincing like the two parties on like how to, or like on what to buy your product?
So often in agriculture they can get subsidized. So a lot of countries will have a program where if the farmer buys a new product, they might get partially subsidized. And so I think it's good to go after those agencies, and if you can convince the agency that this technology will help the growers be more competitive, then they'll try and list growers and try and get some excitement going. So I would say if you think there's an opportunity there, get one of those agencies on board and see if they'll help, and then they'll help you find customers as well. So.
You mentioned Monsanto for a bit, and that like all people said that you can't go against Monsanto. So what exactly, like how exactly is your company placed in a way that people comment that way?
So one of the things we do is we displace the use of pesticides. So when farmers use our product, our data services, they buy less insecticides and less chemicals. And so the big companies like the Monsanto, the Dow, the DuPonts of the world, they will in some way, shape, or form suffer from that. And so what we showed, though, is we showed that the data we collect is also going to transition from older chemicals to newer ones. And so as it turns out, those big chemical companies are actually now going to become our partners. So we actually found a way to work with them.
What's interesting, though, is like with those big companies, you know, you hear this, whether it's computers or any industry, you know, you're always dealing with the monsters. Like how do you expect you've been able to stay ahead of them? Are they, do they have research teams that are coming, that are trailing behind you, or how are you able to protect your space?
You know, those big companies, I mean, they move so slowly, and it takes, I mean, for them, when you talk to them, if there's an opportunity, it takes them probably a year just to look at it, and then a year to plan it, and then a year to develop it. I mean, you're talking years for to get a new product on the market. So there's always a risk that you show a big company your product and they'll just copy it. It's very unlikely, because if they think it's like, well, I have to take care of this now, I can't wait 3 years to have to build it. They could build it internally, but it would take years. And so I'm not that afraid of showing big companies what I do, and then, you know, I show them how I do it, but I show them what I do, and then that gets them excited.
Do you have patents, or is there any sort of intellectual property protection?
Yeah, we have some. It's not our biggest barrier of entry. I think for us, the biggest barrier of entry is being the first one on the farm. So right now, we are the first wireless network on some of the largest farms in the world, and we intend to stay that way. And so as long as we're the first network there, the farmer's not likely to buy another product.
Okay.
And so we're more focused about getting more and more farms on board than we are about filing patents.
What types of channels do you use to promote, sell, and market your product, and which ones out of those do you find to have been the most successful, profits or effectiveness?
So our biggest partner right now in the US is a company called Wilbur Ellis, and they're the largest consulting company for growers. So growers will often hire the services of consultants to help them make decisions on their farm. And so we engage with them, and what we did is we gave them access to the data as well. So if you can imagine, if you're the farmer and you're trying to make decisions and you're always asking me for help, what I did is I sold the tools to the consultant, and they kept on delivering it. So they could then deliver a better service to their customers. And so, and in doing so, you know, again, it's that what's in it for them. So I got them excited, because now when they use Semio's platform, they're delivering a better product to their customers. So they're excited. And that is what kind of gets that whole sales channel going.
So with your pitches, how did you learn to like study the people you're doing your pitches to, and what did you learn about doing like a better pitch?
Yeah, so I probably pitch the company, I don't know, 3 times a week. And I've been doing this for 4 years now. So whether I'm pitching it to investors, partners, customers, you're always trying to sell your company. And so it's definitely worth spending time. And I would say I spend no less than a half an hour, and hopefully more, on every single pitch I give. And just sometimes it means I tweak the deck just by taking one slide out, because this slide doesn't make sense to them. And the last thing you want to do is fast forward through a slide with an investor or with an audience, right? You want to make sure the whole deck is like, it's for them. And take the time to change the title. And I think, just understanding what it is they're going to get from this, and make sure you don't have nothing in there that doesn't, it's not relevant to them. Because it makes it seem like it's a generic pitch, and it doesn't have that personalized approach to it.
Right, so literally put their branding into the deck and make it feel like, hey, I only made one deck for you, and this is especially for you, and then do that for everybody.
And I do make a deck for every person I pitch to, right? So it's a lot of it's recycled, but The first slide is different. It has their name on it, and then it's tailored for them. So,
okay. Well, with that, Michael, on behalf of myself and Sarah Lubick, whose class this is, and our associate dean Andrew Domino, who snuck into the room,
two people that are incredibly passionate about expanding innovation and entrepreneurship at SFU. We'd like to present you with this GIF, and thank you very much for coming and sharing your thoughts with all of our students.
No problem. Thank you.
That's it, we're done.
All right.